Menominees. They were a tribe that liked to wander back and forth throughout the state of Wisconsin. They traveled with the seasons. You had sturgeon in Keshena Falls early in the spring. The sturgeon was literally by the thousands just came up to spawn, and the people more or less could just reach in with their hands, get them and smoke them and preserve them for the year, see? The same way with the deer, and the people migrated with these animals, and each little group had what we'd call a chief. But gradually these white settlers were demanding this as their property. The government was buying this land. The Oneidas were moved over here. They're originally New York Indians. They were going to move the Menominees west. The Menominees said no. They said, we'll take the poorest land, swamp land, everything that the white man doesn't want. On that's where we'll live. It'll be our hunting and fishing.
Then there were two or three bills introduced in Congress to establish national parks or national forests on the Menominee Reservation. And again, the tribe strongly opposed these moves. Then, of course, came the Allotment Act passed by Congress, but the Menominees again resisted that. To perpetuate the forest, they adopted a proposal, which eventually became law, of only selective logging, cutting only the fully ripened and matured timber. The old pine ring back in the old lumberjack days was very much interested in getting in here and cutting the pine, so it's been a constant fight to hang on to the land and the timber and the resources.
The emotional part of the Indian, his whole, his culture, his everything is tied to that land. And everywhere I've been in this United States, among Indians, their feel is that if they have no land, they no longer exist. This is very deep-rooted.
There are several tribes that believe that the Indian came from the earth, and from the earth came the corn, and his teeth was made of the corn, and his legs were given strength from the lightning of the skies, that his hair was the grass of the earth, and his voice was made from the thunder, and that his eyes came from the stars.
In 1854, the Menominees signed their seventh treaty with the United States government. It established this forest area as their reservation, their permanent homeland. During the next 100 years, they developed a successful lumber operation with a sawmill that gave them employment and made enough profit to provide schools, a hospital, welfare, and pay the costs of the local Indian agency. In 1953, Congress passed House Concurrent Resolution 108, which established as congressional policy the termination of certain Indian tribes from federal supervision and control as rapidly as possible. The following year, 1954, the Menominee Indians were terminated. Jerry Greeno was a Menominee delegate to congressional termination hearings.
It was the Congress's, Senate especially, their objective to start getting out of the Indian business, as they termed it. The Interior Committee on Indian Affairs asked the Commissioner of Indian Affairs to pick out a tribe in their order that he thought could be terminated. And of course, I think the Klamaths were first and the Menominees were second. When the termination came on, why, you had, say, 800 adults, yet you only had about 300 jobs. So a lot of people had to leave the reservation, you know, to get work. Of course, they left with insufficient amount of education and very, very few finished college and very few had a trade. So it was mighty hard for a big majority of them to try to make a living.
The protection that the Menominee tribe had under a trust status with the federal government whereby all the lands and the assets of the Menominees were held in trust. Consequently, this kept the tribal assets within the state of Wisconsin confines out of the tax structure.
Richard Dodge was chairman of the first county welfare board.
There were no taxes imposed upon the Menominee Indians or their assets. Prior to termination, if a wrong decision was made, we always had a backup, so to speak, where a final decision was reached in Washington in the BIA. Termination meant that there no longer would be this arrangement, that the Menominees would be responsible for their own assets. They would be responsible to pay the taxes within the confines of the state of Wisconsin, the county structure, the town structure. All tribal assets, all lands of the tribe became the assets of Menominee Corporation, Inc., Menominee Enterprises, Inc. Instead of my being a tribal member post-termination, I became a 100-share stockholder in Menominee Enterprises, Inc. Everybody had kind of emotional feelings about this, what's going to happen, what's going to occur next week, what's going to happen tomorrow morning. And so that final night of reservation status, I went to bed, and the next morning I got up and jumped in my car and drove downtown and looked around, and I said, well, nothing has really changed. And the thing that really struck me, I think, was that I felt I had education and had been outside working and come home and been able to look at this total picture objectively, and here I was, you know, emotionally disturbed over the whole thing, and I begin to feel, my gosh, what's going to happen to the rest of the people who have never been away from here, who didn't have the education? As a boy growing up here, my attitude about the mill was, if I went to Neopit and saw a lot of logs piled up, I knew we were making money. I didn't know how it was made, where it came from, or how dollars wound up where. But if I saw a lot of logs, we were making money. If I saw no logs, I got concerned.
When the government terminated the Menominees, they talked in terms of Menominees not existing anymore, because the way they define an Indian is you have to be a fourth Indian blood, you have to be on a tribal roll, and you have to be under the BIA. And see, the only criteria that the Menominees don't come up to is being under BIA, but this is a big one. So they just say Menominees are no longer Indians.
What we're trying to do is thousands and thousands of years as a lifestyle to change that with termination. We have our lifestyle that was maintained to live with the land and not to tear down trees and put up an industry. I think a good example is before termination here on the reservation. The mill employed a lot of the men around here, and I know my father worked at the mill quite a few times, and he'd quit to go trapping for a certain number of months. He'd come back and he'd get a job. Now, this is the Indian lifestyle, not to work until you're 65 and then die, but to enjoy life while you're young.
They were never trained to punch a clock. You were trained to hunt and fish when the necessity was there. If you had killed two or three deer and there was plenty of meat, you didn't have to go out. So you did something else. So you had to shift from that whole approach, and then this reservation status with the subsistence and the helps and this type of thing, handouts coming down from the Great White Father, never necessitated having to be at a certain place at a certain time. So this was never developed. Right here, prior termination, we used to have tremendous problems in terms of fellows either missing Monday and Tuesday and coming Wednesday and being fired, and then walking around the mill yard around to another foreman and say, you got any openings? And the guy says, yeah, I just fired two guys. So he starts there, and it took a lot of training, and I think they're not over it yet.
Thank you.
You've got to live with us to see how we get by. We lived with the Menominees for several months. They told us about their culture, their history, their termination from federal control, and the current divisions within the tribe over land sales to support the county. Except for mine, the voices you hear are the Menominees telling you their story. The Menominees have been more fortunate than many Indian tribes. Their leaders were able to negotiate a reservation within the boundaries of their original homeland. According to their sacred folklore, they came from a great bear which emerged from the Menominee River less than 100 miles from their present county. For centuries, they lived in their wigwam villages in the heart of the wild rice region around Green Bay, Wisconsin. Their name, Manomen, is an Algonquin word for wild rice. 20,000 other Indians were forced into the Menominee area by European migrations in the 1600s. With these Indians came the French, who brought guns, liquor, knives, utensils, ribbons, and beads. The transition to a new lifestyle that would replace thousands of years of Indian traditions began. Their villages dissolved into small bands of fur trappers. Their chiefs, who traced their ancestry to the Great Bear, were replaced by leaders who could make the best deals with the French fur traders. Fur traders, soldiers, and government officials entered into tribal life and intermarried. Today, the old Menominee culture, with the secret medicine lodge religion, the shaman or medicine man, and an elaborate system of root medicine, is gone. Few speak the language anymore, and Zor, the last village of Menominees who preferred to live the traditional Indian way, is disappearing.
They migrated over there solely for the purpose of getting away from civilization. Buses would come in load the kids up, and take them to the different government schools where they were taught English, and they were brought back again during vacation. In Zora, nothing but Menominee was spoken. When they went back to school in September, they had to learn to speak English all over again. There, the people followed the tradition, the rituals, the dances, the different feasts that were a part of the tribal heritage. Their burial ceremonies are different than the outsiders, you might say, because they have the little huts that they build, the little shelters, with the opening where you can feed or bring a gift to that person, so that gift will enable them, in our tradition, to make the crossing from here to the other side. And once he gets to the other side, he has his offering of tobacco to make to the Great Spirit.
Now, the religious part, just the members I wanted in, see. They call the medicine dance. We don't have that anymore because all the old timers that knew the rules and regulations of this, they're all passed away. And as far as my generation is concerned, most of the time I was away to school, and I didn't have the time with my father so that he could tell me different things, learn me. The south wind dance, the 49, the squaw dance, those are old, they're not religious dances, they're social. People used to get together, they used to practically dance all night. Just to be sociable one another. They give gifts to one another. Some old gentleman or old lady would come towards us, he'd offer us something, you know, gift. But when you get that, well, when you're going to get up and dance, well, some of them would give ponies away. Of course, now they, most of this now is just for show business, you know.
The French came to exploit the fur trade and not to colonize. For 90 years, they secured Indian loyalty and cooperation through a steady flow of presents, but the Americans wanted the land, and they established a system of control that developed into the Bureau of Indian Affairs, the BIA. At first, they recognized the tribes as independent nations. The first Menominee Treaty in 1817 said, "There shall be perpetual peace and friendship between all the citizens of the United States and all individuals of the Menominee Nation." 40 years later, still proclaiming perpetual peace and friendship, the United States government bought the last of the Menominee Nation's aboriginal homeland. over 300,000 settlers had moved into Wisconsin. The Menominees were to be moved to Minnesota, but when their chiefs surveyed the area, they realized they would not survive among the more powerful Plains tribes, and they negotiated this reservation, one-third the size, but with the emotional ties of home.
The Indians always did live in this area, a group that was down around Lake Oregon, Oshkosh, and through that area, Appleton, Fox River Valley. The army made a move up here. These Indians were forced to paddle their way up Wolf River. Fall rains and all that had already settled in, making the water quite high. And these people done that with their families, gotten old people, grandparents and that. A lot of older people, they couldn't make it. A lot of people drowned it. A lot of Indian people drowned it along the way. The boats tipped over and they couldn't save some of the children. When they landed at Kashina, the Catholic convert landed on the north bank of Kashina, the present village of Kashina. And that priest that was along with a missionary opened a mission there and got a village started that way.
Today, Kashina, 50 miles west of Green Bay, Wisconsin, is the county seat of Menominee County. For the last 150 years, missionaries have lived with the Menominees. They opened the first schools and the hospital, paid for by the tribe and free to all Menominees. At termination, this hospital had to be closed. It could not meet the rigid state standards, and the costs as a private hospital would be too high. Today, the Menominees are 80% Catholic.
When you're all together, then your chin is fixed together. You know, chin is a little bit in your neck. That's good.
But Catholic influence with the Menominees dates back to the French. The first whites to live with them were the French Jesuits who arrived in 1669. It was also the French who first involved the Menominees in the white man's wars. They encouraged the tribes to live at peace with each other and fight with them against the British. Both the French and the Menominees joined the British against the Americans in the War of 1812. 20 years later, the Menominees had switched their allegiance to the American government. They have fought in every major American war since. They sent two companies to fight with the Union forces in the Civil War. And like other Americans, they have honored their war dead with Memorial Day services since the establishment of this national holiday in 1868.
Every time I look at the flag, you know, there's 50 stars on there, and then the 13 stripes. And I always think of all the men that are dying now in Vietnam, all the Indian men. And then I think back to when my ancestors, my forefathers, fought against the flag. Why aren't we mentioning those men that died centuries ago, that have died in intertribal wars? Where is that staff of eagle feathers that belongs out there alongside of the United States flag? I just can't understand how our people can forget all that.
After 100 years of Indian Affairs supervision, Congress gave the Menominees 3 years to take over the administration of their own affairs. The few Menominees who had finished high school had little management experience. An even smaller number who had gone to college had found jobs elsewhere. The average educational level for all Indians under federal supervision is only 8 school years. Indian dropout rates are twice the national average. On national tests, Indian children score lower than white children at every grade level. Most Indian schools are elementary schools. Children wanting to go to high school travel 10 to 50 miles to a local public school, or several hundred miles to an Indian boarding school where they stay for 9 months. Few of their parents can afford to bring them home for the Christmas holidays. Only since termination have programs begun to attack the Menominee educational problems. A community action summer program concentrates on reading difficulties. two Head Start programs help preschool and kindergarten children adjust to school. And a Title III program under the supervision of the University of Wisconsin is studying learning difficulties. They attribute much of the problem to the Indian child's lack of identity. He is in a vacuum. His own culture has been destroyed, and the new culture in which he finds himself does not include him. Carol Dodge is the only Menominee teacher in the county. She set up the Head Start program and has worked with the Title III program. She talked to us about the problems they have found and the changes they are making in the curriculum.
One of the reasons for bringing in the Title III program to locate specific learning problems or difficulties of the children in Menominee County, we're way below even the district norms. I think it's mostly the materials they have found, and some of it was the teachers, the attitudes. What they're doing now is working up a curriculum using different types of materials, and they are trying to incorporate the Indian culture into as many phases of the curriculum as possible. Some of it has been instrumental in getting some of these children to read. Take, for instance, the unit on transportation. We start out with what the old-time Indians used, or why they used the canoe and the snowshoe, and then we're contrasting that with present-day Indians, what they are using. We're not just staying with the old culture, we're bringing them up to today.
The program uses local Indians to teach their language and to talk about the culture.
Keskiminauk means our forefathers used, you know, these boats. Keskiminauk, Yokisopok.
What is it? And in the history books, it's always focused totally on what the Europeans, how great it was for them to come over. I think it's this not putting the Indian in today's society. In fact, they don't do this with any of the minorities. They don't put them in today's society. When they're here in the community, nothing is said to them about being Indian. And all your friends are Indians, your relatives are Indians. So you never really think about it. And when you're in the grade schools, they don't prepare you. They teach the old-time Indians, and they teach that they were savages and how the bad things they did to the white people and the little children and all this sort of thing. But then they cut these units off. They don't bring the Indian up to today. They know their ancestors were Indians, but then they don't see themselves as being this type of an Indian. The child is a product of his environment. These children here come from an Indian community, and they are different than what you would find in a child from a white community.
Ripon College in Oshkosh and Wisconsin State University at Stevens Point have summer and winter upward bound programs to help Menominee High School students with academic and cultural problems.
Negative numbers. We're going to have to go through that kind of fast because we're going to have to get done by Friday.
Upward Bound is a federally funded program to work with disadvantaged youth, the group that there is a chance that they could go on to higher education. We try to take 10% of your best students, 10% of your worst students, and then the rest from in between.
10 less than the sum of 4 times the number and 2 times the number. What's the sum of 4 times the number and 2 times the number?
We find out where they're weak and where they're strong, and one of the main purposes, I think, of Upward Bound is to see that these kids become aware of these other alternatives when they leave high school, especially with your college, you know, to get them into the college education, into the college system.
It's knowing that you can go on to college and you don't have to be a welder, you don't have to be a machinist, you don't have to be a laborer, things like this. One thing we were really mad about was there was 18 Indians on University of Wisconsin campus, and there were 36,000 students there. They tried to recruit, but they couldn't find any. And then we had a conference last year, and we found 500 Indian kids, high school kids, that were interested in coming down for an educational cultural awareness program. And they couldn't believe that we found 500 of them. But it's becoming more and more apparent that any study programs are becoming feasible. Like there's one at Minnesota, there's one at Berkeley, Albuquerque, Missoula, Denver. The language that's required to get a degree, say like in Minnesota is Chippewa, Albuquerque, it's whatever tribe you're at, it might be Navajo, things like this. And these kids are finally out that they can go on to college and they can compete on it once they're brought up to that level.
In their earlier Algonquin culture, the Menominees hunted, fished, gathered berries and maple sugar, and raised small gardens. But their principal food was wild rice. When the government moved them to their reservation, they were confined to a much smaller area, and the wild rice lakes were owned by whites. The government's intention was to stop their roving by making the Menominees a tribe of farmers. Under the terms of the Menominee Treaty, the Indian Agency supplied tools, seed, stock, and a farm advisor, but the government settled them in sandy soil, and within 15 years, the soil was depleted. Menominees who wanted to farm had to move to new areas, clear new fields, and begin again. Today, there are two farms in Menominee County.
We own 225 acres.
And how much of that did you and your husband clear yourself?
Well, I would say about 70 acres.
And how did you clear it?
He chopped the trees down and I helped him, you know, pile them up and burn them, burn the brush.
You raise most of the food and can it and everything from the
Yes. I freeze an awful lot now. I used to can an awful lot. I imagine I've had about 900 quarts of vegetables and fruit like berries and rasp and applesauce and jams. When the family was smaller, then we could really go pick the berries. Now it's only Mr. and I that will pick berries. So this year, all I got was 8 quarts of raspberries.
How big was your family altogether?
We had 20 children, and with the grandchildren now, it adds up to quite a few. We have 65 now. I got 3 grandchildren staying with me now. So it's like that every summer, we always have houseful. Years ago, when my father was young, the government tried to encourage him into farming. And practically there must have been about 50 or 60 farms right here in South Branch area. And they all had about 15, 20 acres. I know my father had about 25 acres. But he used to raise mostly hay and oats because he logged a lot in the winter time. See, that time it was really different logging than they do now. You know, it was all teamwork. And when he was logging, well, they used to give out, everybody could get a contract for about 10,000 feet of logs to log out.
The Menominees were not allowed to cut or sell their timber until 1872. Then they were permitted to log in winter if they farmed in summer. Within 40 years, they had more than $2 million in their tribal account. But the Menominees had a constant battle to protect their forest from white lumbermen. In 1908, a congressional bill forbid bureau contracts with white loggers. This bill, introduced by Senator Robert La Follette, established sustained yield cutting, no more than 20 million board feet and only fully grown timber. It also approved a sawmill to be built with Menominee money. Because of bureau mismanagement of their forest, the Menominees in 1935 brought 5 lawsuits against the federal government. In 1951, they won $8.5 million in settlement of these claims. This brought their tribal account to $10.5 million and made them a candidate for termination. Menominee delegates told Congress their mill was old and the forest would not grow as much timber as government studies indicated. Jerry Greeno explains.
When the government was basing their justification for terminating the Menominees was the fact that they said their studies showed that the forest on a sustained yield would yield around 30 million. That's not true. It's down to 22 and 24 million. So if you lost, well, it would be 6 million or 8 million feet that you'd figure on when you could help sustain the local government, which we lost. I haven't changed my opinion, and I testified before the Senate Interior Committee that if we had to carry the full responsibilities of a colony, it would just be impossible. With just few people in a small area, it's fortunate that we're integrated with Shawano for education, law and order, and so forth.
All you got here is an old mill, and that was one of the things we said, and which is proven right, that you were limited to what you could make with this old mill. I would say it's built in 1926. Well, that's quite a few years old. Instead of the mill itself trying to put some money, what they earn, and become modern, why, all it went for was taxes.
When we try to get industry in here, it's to build a tax base. First, you're competing with all the other towns that they want the business to come in there, and they give them a break on taxes. They don't have pay tax. You can put up buildings for them and so forth.
In testifying before the Joint Committee of the House and Senate on Indian Affairs, we pointed out that our gravest concern was the economy, that we needed new sources of income, new opportunities of employment. We needed diversification of our industry and better utilization of our raw materials.
While Congress required tribes to make termination plans, they frequently ignored tribal suggestions. In some cases, they neglected to notify state governments where the tribes were located. Gordon Dickey was on the Menominee Planning Commission.
We organized the Planning Commission in 1953, and we were extremely concerned and worried about this situation. We didn't know where to turn. Finally turned to the governor of the state of Wisconsin, former Governor Walter Kohler. And to our amazement, we found at that time that the state government, none of its agencies, had any idea of what was going on this termination. That the federal government had at no time contacted them to bring them up to date as to what was taking place. Even our proposals, as they finally were adopted by the tribe, were not followed out completely by the Congress. Originally, we had proposed taking over just certain parts of the operation, a step at a time, in an orderly manner, so that the secretary would still be in the picture to check periodically as to how we were doing and what mistakes we were making and how he could be of assistance to us. But this was not done.
The Menominee Termination Act called for the termination of the tribe from federal supervision by 1956. But the Menominees managed to get two extensions. On May 15, 1960, the delegation seeking the final extension arrived on Capitol Hill. Irene Mac Quijano was a member of the delegation.
We went to every senator, every congressman, to try to bring our problem to them, to tell them about the termination, what it's going to mean to our people. We were trying to get an extension of time. We thought we could get a 2 or 3 year extension, which we believed was the most feasible thing. But as a result, we had to settle for only 6 months, and then we had some good friends who had to do some horse trading to get that for us.
We had our own hospital system. We had our own welfare system for our old people that are sick and needy. We had our own police department.
Here we were, a group of Indian people that was able to provide all these community services for ourselves, and we paid for them. They were not paid, as some people understand on the outside, by the taxpayers.
We sued the government for $8.5 million, and we beat them. And when we beat Uncle Sam, that was more or less our downfall. They said, well, we'll have to terminate these guys. They got enough money.
I seen the hospital close down, I seen the courthouse close down, I seen the jail close down, the dental and medical services, they're gone.
And then we have no ambulance, which we always did have before termination. And I have to pay anywhere from $4 to $6 and travel 20 miles to see my doctor.
We can't do anything, because I wrote to senators and congressmen and sent those petitions to the president thinking it would help. Nothing.
The concept of termination. Remove government restrictions only when Indians believe they can manage their own affairs. In the 50s, the policy shifted to pressuring tribes to accept termination. 11 major tribes were terminated before this policy was dropped. Untrained in managing their own assets, some were told by Congress to put their land in trusts controlled by private banks, more restrictive than the Bureau. Others sold their land, and some were on local welfare within a few years. In an attempt to hold on to their land, the Menominees incorporated their reservation. But they knew they were inexperienced, and their own termination plan called for a non-Indian president and a board of directors with an... 42% of the Menominees were under 21. As guardian of these minors, the First Wisconsin Trust Company of Milwaukee voted 42% of the stock. The motivating force behind termination was Senator Arthur Watkins of Utah. Elected in a Republican sweep of 1946, this junior senator became chairman of the Indian Subcommittee. The committee promptly began termination hearings, but the Democrats soon regained control of Congress and the issue was dropped. In 1953, there was again a Republican majority. It now took the Indian Subcommittee only 2 months to get House Concurrent Resolution 108, the termination policy, through both houses of Congress.
In 1953, a simple per capita bill was introduced by Congressman Mel Laird asking for distribution of tribal funds. In the Senate, under the chairmanship of former Senator Arthur V. Watkins, there were 13 amendments to that simple bill that provided for termination of the tribe by 1956. When I was acting chairman of the tribal council, I called an open meeting in the village of Neopit, and the tribe, in the largest vote in my memory, voted 197 to nothing not to accept the per capita payment as long as these termination provisions had been inserted into the original bill.
Despite their vote against termination, Menominee leaders suspected that any plan to use their $10.5 million would be blocked until they agreed to termination. All Indians must get the approval of Congress before they can spend their tribal funds. The Menominees wanted to spend their claim settlement in three ways: mill improvements and new business, investments, a $1,500 payment to each tribal member. In 1952, the proposal was rejected by the Bureau of Indian Affairs because it did not include a termination plan. In 1953, the same bill was stopped by the Indian Subcommittee for the same reason. Tribal leaders invited Senator Watkins to explain termination to a general council at the reservation. At the end of the senator's two-hour visit, not only the leaders, but individual tribal members believed that they would not get their $1,500 until they voted for termination. They voted 169-5 in favor of termination. Over 90% of these people made less than $1,000 a year. In addition to $1,500, each Menominee at termination received 100 shares of stock in Menominee Enterprises and a $3,000 bond. Under the plan, ownership of all Menominee lands now passed to Menominee Enterprises. Many individual Menominees only realized later that they no longer owned any land. They had to buy back the land on which they had built their homes, land where their families had lived for generations.
The Indians are going to lose the land. I mean, they lost it already. But they get $1,500, then they had to buy back their property. I guess my parents got $1,500, and then it cost them $200 to $200 to buy back their property. So they were $700 in a debt already. Or like either they took their bonds, and then they sold them or put them in a hawk, things like this. You know, they had to get money to pay their taxes. They had to pay taxes now, and they never had to pay before. Their hospital is gone. So then they had to go to Shawnee after termination. And then, you know, a lot of them couldn't pay. They're not used to paying a doctor's bill. And then if they couldn't pay it, they couldn't go back. The only way a lot of them paid it was that they gave them their bonds. Well, even this one lawyer has got $250,000 worth of bonds down there now just for legal fees. And he collects $120 for every one of them bonds, not the Indian.
Over 70% of the people still make less than the $3,000 poverty level. Manpower training and community action programs provide training, but there are few jobs in the county, and most of the factories are 50 to 60 miles away. Like most poverty people, the Menominees cannot depend on their old cars to make this daily trip. For over 100 years, the Menominee Indians had cost the federal government practically nothing. Since 1954, the Menominees have received nearly $10 million in special grants for housing, schools, sewers, roads, health, and welfare. In 1970, the welfare costs were nearly $700,000. the unemployment rate still averaged 20%. In 1911, the Menominees have held a summer homecoming for members working off the reservation. Today, it is the Menominee County Fair. Indians' cultural attitude toward nature is a combination of affinity and necessity. To him, nature is a brother as well as a provider. The forest provides shelter for the animals, and without clear streams, the fish cannot survive. The Indian kills only what he needs for food. And while he thanks the Great Spirit for providing the deer, he apologizes to the deer for needing the food. Non-Indian Americans have polluted their streams and clear-cut their forests. They now find that what they set aside for national parks can no longer accommodate their exploding population. Both the state of Wisconsin and the federal government want to buy the land along the Wolf River. The federal government has designated it a wild and scenic river, and the National Park Service is negotiating with the Menominees for its purchase. The state of Wisconsin pays them $250,000 a year for public fishing and camping rights. Menominee County has no capital to develop this recreational potential. The Economic Development Administration and the Upper Great Lakes Regional Commission granted $1 million for tourist facilities. The motel and restaurant, representing the greatest potential for jobs and income, are still in the planning stage. But nature and cultural buildings were opened in October of 1970. Menominee County became the 72nd county in Wisconsin and the first Indian county in the United States on May 1, 1961. Of their $10.5 million, less than $2 million was left. Menominee Enterprises paid over 90% of the taxes for the support of the county. They had no money left for expansion. They could not pay dividends on their stock. If they did not become a viable economy, they could not continue as a county. If they did not pay dividends, the shareholders would sell when the stock became negotiable. If the corporation could not buy the shares, the state had the second option. With 51% of the shares, the state could turn Menominee County into a state park. Four independent studies recommended the development of a summer home project around the lakes in the southern part of the county. The lots would be sold to non-Menominee taxpayers. In partnership with a Wisconsin developer, Menominee Enterprises combined several small lakes to make Legend Lake. Ted Boyd, Vice President of Business Development, talked to us about the corporation's dilemma and the development of the lake project.
Menominee Enterprises would be on the brink of bankruptcy right now if we had not gone into this program. The Legend Lake development was necessary in the respect that it will relieve our tax burden. The project involves 2,600 properties. It will add at least $25 million to our tax base. It is estimated that it'll take us down to around 40%, perhaps less. But this will be 40% again of an increasing tax levy. Now, this is not because of services so much as it is because of school costs. The people who are buying the Legend Lake properties will not add appreciably to the cost of school operation because they are a seasonal type resident. We formed a joint venture named Lakes of the Menominees. Lakes of the Menominees owns and operates Legend Lake. The joint venture is a 50-50 arrangement.
In the first years when we talked about developing the lakes, we wanted to do it on a lease basis. Most of the people that were interested also wanted to acquire the land. I was absolutely opposed to issuing a deed to the property to other than a Menominee Indian. So I challenged them and told them that if the board of directors would call the council of the shareholders, and we brought just for this one purpose.
James Frechette has been a tribal leader for 40 years.
I would be willing to abide by any decision that they made. The people who attended the council, which was a good-sized council, decided to issue the deed along with the property, a deed to the property.
The way we decided to go was to try and keep the property private and kind of appeal to people that could pay taxes and let them share our heritage or our land. The situation is unique. You don't find a private enterprise supporting a whole county with the amount of people that are coming into Wisconsin. This is an ideal recreation area.
When Menominee County was a reservation, all of the Menominees owned all of the land. They were the only people allowed to fish or canoe on Wolf River. They were free to go to any lake at any time and to build there if they wished. Today, Menominee Enterprises owns the land and the Menominees are shareholders in a complicated legal entity called a corporation, which they don't understand and over which many feel they have no control. They have received no dividends on their shares. The first lake to be ringed by lots, owned by non-Menominees, was Lake Meshaquit, their most beautiful lake and their favorite spot. There are only 500 Menominee families living in the county. There will be 2,600 homes at Legend Lake. Few Menominees can afford the $5,000 to $7,000 for the lake lots. Within 2 years, 1,200 lots had been sold. As the Menominees watched the homes being built, many feared that the outsiders were building retirement homes. If only 25% of the lake families became permanent residents, they will outnumber the Menominees. As permanent residents, they will be able to vote and to run for office.
My fellow Menominees, let me just ask you a few questions. Are you really satisfied with what's happening today? Are you satisfied? You don't want to do something about it? Okay, that's why we're here.
Their fear of losing their land erupted in 1970 in a summer of weekend demonstrations, emotional meetings, and renewed bitterness over termination. On the 4th of July, a group of Indian children who were swimming near the sales office were chased off by a salesman. Within an hour, they were back to picket.
I've been kicked off the lake. I used to go swimming there whenever I wanted to, anytime. And there weren't any people there to tell me that I couldn't. I used to go hunting there, ducks and fishing. And there isn't a person out there that can't say that hasn't changed. But I want my land back, and I don't want all these people around, and I have a right to do this.
The reason that many of my people voted to remain a separate county is because they wanted to maintain their separateness and their identity. But now we are being beset and besieged by white settlers. We are the minority. We are going to become second-class citizens in our own backyard. These are some of my feelings on the Termination Act. which was designed to supposedly free the Indian from federal supervision to make him equal to other U.S. citizens. In actual practice, all that it amounted to was to force the Indian to pay taxes on his land.
You as a Menominee should be that proud Menominee who owns 100 shares of stock, whether you feel that it's a worthless piece of paper or not, but it entitles me to 100 votes.
I know that some of you have either sold your bond or put it in pawn, and this is a necessity, I realize this. But remember one thing, you do not lose that vote when you sell that bond. The votes lie in the stocks that you hold, which can't be sold yet. So you own that vote, and you're entitled to that vote, regardless of what the status of your bond is.
Menominee Enterprise, that's the only place I ever worked, and I want to keep working there, continue. Now we'll bring up the lakes here. So many people were out there last Sunday demonstrating. Did it get you any place? Look at it this way, that was just a scrub oak over in that territory. A lot of little lakes. So what they did is made one big lake and bringing in money. Now you are hollering.
I didn't give this land up. This land belongs to the Menominee Indian people. I don't believe they have a right to sell our land. We want to keep our land. We love our homeland here. It's valuable to us. This is all we have. And we don't want anybody selling it.
In lieu of what I had to say, I would like to sing a song that's all right with this about Kashina, the way I look at it.
In the land of azure waters where virgin pines grow tall, it is said God made a garden most wonderful of all. For the red man, he created it on earth when time began. Why, it was so serene and beautiful, in truth paradisian. A land of sparkling waters where hills were evergreen. A place of purest happiness and sorrow, why, was never seen. Here fruit grew in abundance, no lack of fish or game. Birds warbled in the treetops and praised their maker's name.
We gave 5 million acres for a promise, for a home to be held as Indian land is held, tax-free. It took 5 million acres to do that. If the federal government did not violate any of our treaties, why should we be selling that land in order to pay our taxes?
I think Menominee Enterprises was saddled with an unusual responsibility. We were told to go out and make a profit. From a pure business standpoint, the Lakes of the Menominees was the logical and the only way to go. There's 5,170 acres included in the Lakes of the Menominees project. But this 2% of our land will benefit the remaining lands. It will enable us to pay our taxes, enable the county government to function as it should. But from a social standpoint, no matter what success is achieved in Lakes of the Menominees, it's not going to be accepted.
It just seems so impossible that a land so rich can't support 2,700 people. There must be some way, and I think it's almost crazy for an Indian to buy his own land. I mean, you know, like we were discussing what aboriginal rights were, and I feel that land is definitely an aboriginal right for the Indian.
Obviously, the 100-some-odd years that the reservations have existed under the federal government certainly has not been a success when we look at the problems that exist today, the unemployment, the housing, the drinking, the lack of job opportunities. If this is what a reservation has to be, then I think it's been a complete failure. We should be looking in terms of another direction. Whether termination is a success for the Menominees, we're at least another 10 years away from that answer. If it means having to sell more land than we presently have sold, then I would say it's a failure. It's an absolute failure. Anyone in business today will tell you don't sell your assets and stay in business. You retain your assets and you build your assets. You don't sell them. And as I say, the feeling of the Indian for the land, and if that goes, then everything we've worked for is gone.